Good afternoon. My name is Brendan Laporte. I'm a mechanical engineering major and a senior at Montana State University. I'm joined by Brendan, Caleb, and Bryce, and today we're going to talk to you about our year and our design process for this season. So for the agenda, first we're going to go into our team background and structure. Then we're going to talk about our baseline testing and what we did to establish those tests. We're going to talk about our design innovations, the fabricated components we were actually able to bring to competition this year. We're going to talk about the challenges we faced throughout the year, as well as our future plans for next competition. Snowmobile we're running is a Polaris switchback assault, the 2019 chassis, a Polaris Clean Fire 2015 engine, it's two-stroke. We're using BASF bimetal catalytic converters, and our MSRP value for this year was $13,502. So for our team organization, we have a hierarchical structure with three officers, myself the president, vice president and treasurer, and under that is four build teams, split into the catalytic converter build team, muffler build team, expansion chamber build team, and electronics team. They're each headed by one team lead.
So my name is Caleb Bielma. I'm a freshman in mechanical engineering. The first thing we wanted to do was establish a set of stock data to compare back to. So what we did was we established some procedures, and most of what we were able to do was strictly qualitative testing, because we didn't have the very precise recording equipment required to get the numbers. So for sound, what we did was we used the Destrolex iPhone application, and we stood 9 feet away, handheld with the microphone facing towards the sled. And then we ran the sled at various RPMs on our warm-up stand to simulate a trail environment. For emissions, we did the white glove test as suggested by several in-service emissions judges last year. And so what we did was we cleaned the exhaust, took a clean rag, ran the sled for a little bit, again simulating the trail environment, and cleaned it out to see what kind of particulates we had accumulated on the rag. For fuel economy, we made a dipstick to ensure that every time we refilled the sled, we'd be able to fill it to the same amount and measure the amount of fuel we used. We ran the sled for 1 hour, as you would if you were riding for a day, and then filled it up, measured it, and went off the odometer.
I'm Brendan. I'm a sophomore mechanical engineering student. So an expansion chamber is a useful tool for minimizing the performance losses associated with a two-stroke engine due to unspent fuel, prematurely leaving the crankcase through the exhaust manifold, and spent fuel leaking back into, or prematurely leaving the combustion chamber through the exhaust manifold, or spent fuel leaking back into the crankcase during the piston downstroke. However, the pressure wave responsible for the increased scavenging can only be tuned to provide substantial benefit over a narrow RPM range, or a small amount of benefit over a wide RPM range. Our dual expansion chamber system, however, solves this issue by making use of an autonomous diversion valve, which can direct the exhaust flow into either our custom chamber, broadly tuned towards mid to high RPM ranges, or towards a mid to high RPM range, or the stock chamber, narrowly tuned towards a high RPM range. So here you can see an exploded view drawing of that valve. The valve was designed and fabricated by the 2018-2019 senior design team, which we employed to help us out with our design. In order to get the geometry, or to calculate the geometry of our custom chamber, we needed to take a few measurements. Some of the most prominent of those measurements were the engine timing, measured using a degree wheel, the port geometry, measured by tracing the internal ports, and then converted into this drawing above, the exhaust valve mapping, that was measured as shown here. There's the exhaust valve. And together, this was made into a model as seen here. That model was able to then be used to find the area of the control surface leaving the engine at any RPM range once we knew when the valve was turned. So, this is a screenshot of the program that we used to calculate our chamber geometry. Shown here is the ideal chamber geometry. This program is based on design and simulation of two-stroke engines by Gordon Blair. Here are the input parameters. Most of these were described previously. These are constants that allowed us to tune the range over which the chamber would be effective. So the muffler was made to be a scaled-down version of the stock muffler. We found out that the stock muffler essentially routed the exhaust gas through an S-shaped curve of perforated tubing, and was surrounded by insulating material for which we used steel wool. The scaled down design was so that we could interface with our combustion or our expansion chamber.
For the catalytic converters, we decided that based on space and size constraints, we made the design decision to place the catalytic converters in series. The location of it was after the expansion chamber and before the muffler. After the expansion chamber to allow for proper scavenging, as Brendan previously described, and before the muffler so we could more accurately control the temperature. We talked with BASF and they recommend we use a bimetal catalytic converter to primarily target hydrocarbons and carbon monoxide, so that's what we went with.
I'm Bryce Wolin. I'm a senior electrical engineering, part of the electronics team. The electronics team this year made a control system using Arduino Uno and a filtering circuit to take an input from an ethanol sensor. The output from the ethanol sensor was then routed to a Dynojet Power Commander 5, which could on the fly adjust the engine mapping to compensate for the ethanol content in the fuel. On the top right is our Power Commander, which was installed in the sled. Bottom left, this is one of the engine maps for testing we made, and the right is a oscilloscope probe data we used to test our RC filter circuit. Here is a wiring schematic of the control system we made, a few example inputs, example output. We also added an LCD screen so that was mounted in the dash of the snowmobile so that the user could read the ethanol content in real time down to 2 decimal points. Here's some of the coding we use to process the signal from the ethanol sensor to allow it to communicate with the power commander's analog input in our Arduino.
So, in our final iteration of the sled, we have the exhaust diversion valve as previously shown. It has been pinned to only one chamber due to complications with the motor overheating and spacing in the engine bay. That chamber is the custom chamber that we designed using a hydroforming procedure that will be touched on more extensively in a few slides from now. It leads to a custom muffler, which is almost exactly as previously described and shown, with a slight change to the external geometry in order to better interface with our chamber.
Great. For the catalytic converters, due to our previous design decision to place them in series, we put them into a pipe and welded them in place.
And the electronic control system I previously talked about is installed in the snowmobile.
Right, so some of the challenges we faced with catalytic converters, our design decision to place them in series ended up causing us a lot of issues, primarily with overheating, low pressure, and high back pressure that caused the engine to run very poorly and was unusable. Our first attempt to solve this problem was just to remove one of the two catalytic converters.
So the hydroforming procedure we used made it difficult for us to achieve the desired geometry, where the cross-section would have to be sweeped over 3 planes. As a result, our chamber deviated slightly from the intended geometry.
The electronics team had a few issues with just electronics fragility. The valve motor that would be needed to operate the diversion valve was in a very high heat environment. It took a lot of current to keep it going, and it didn't always respond properly. We had a lot of issues and just troubles with general connections and durability of our electronics equipment.
One of the big things was time management. Last year we had trouble with that as well, so we created a Gantt chart with deadlines that we were going to try and follow. But over the course of the year, we strayed away from that and lacked the discipline to stick with it, giving ourselves plenty of time to deal with the problems that we couldn't see that would arise with our designs. We also unfortunately lost some key team members. Our build team leader for the catalytic converter team had to separate from the team for personal reasons, and as a result, the officers, myself, and the other 2 officers were unable to really tackle that problem and make sure that it got solved in a timely manner. And because of that, because of our failure, we had to shoehorn it in a series design instead of parallel like we did last year. Build team interfacing was also a big problem. The build teams were separated, but they didn't have a lot of cross communication, made it very difficult to make sure that each of the components was implemented well together, which is why the external geometry had to change for the muffler and a couple other things. We also had a lack of testing equipment. We don't have a dyno, we don't have an exhaust gas analyzer, and we were not given permission to drive the snowmobile on campus, and it was very difficult for us to transport it somewhere else to drive with the lack of snow in Montana this year. So we'll be solving that
addition to that, we're going to re-implement the dual catalytic converters like we had last year in parallel. That way we have lower flow resistance as opposed to being in series like we did this year. And then in addition to that, we are going to move it to the tunnel with the muffler. And then, so last year we sponsored the senior design team to build the valve like you saw before. This year we sponsored them to build us an engine dyno, so next year we'll be able to more accurately test and get metrics on our engine before we become a competition, as well as we got access to an exhaust gas analyzer. So we plan on purchasing the tooling required to use that.
Sweet. So we're also going to implement more effective deadlines, because at the end of the day, problems arise and we need to have the time to solve it. So we're going to work with the team to find a way to stick to the deadlines that we create, make sure that we have enough time to overcome the obstacles in a timely manner. We're not just trying to rush at the end to put something together to come to competition. We want to make sure that we come to competition with a snowmobile that competes well, not one that just barely survives.
We also want to integrate the motor for the diversion valve once we do have both the expansion chambers installed. This might be used with some couplers to keep it away from the heat. We wanted to use a printed circuit board as well to get rid of all our connection issues. Just have the entire circuit printed, easy to use. Our liquid crystal display turned into a solid crystal display this year with the temperature outside. So we're going to go with an LED to display it next year as well to solve that issue.
Awesome. Well, we'd like to thank all of you guys for coming out here, helping with the competition and giving us feedback on all of our design. We'd also like to thank our sponsors who helped us get this far and helped us compete for a second year in a row, especially some department key individuals, Dr. Dan Miller, Dr. Dilpreet Bajwa, Glenn Foster,